Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's. This is a place where
grace abounds.
And grace abounds for us. On the 17th Sunday after Pentecost, we have a number of upcoming events. They were up on the screen, but there's one I want to definitely highlight is that there's a new date for the food collection. We have been saying today was the food collection. Barbara Grant's not able to be here today, so she's coming next Sunday for that food collection. So I apologize for that. Next Sunday will be that food collection after the service on Sunday, September 22nd. The day before that, this Saturday, we've got a number of things, Ladies' Aid meeting and also the Rib Fest at the Life. You should have this insert in your bulletin. This gives more information about the Rib Fest. This is the Circuit 7 fancy word convocation. Which is just a fancy word for church picnic. We're going to be holding this at the Life with all 8 churches in our immediate circuit. 1:30 is the worship service, and 3 o'clock is the Rib Fest. There's a number of events you can see down there. Hopefully, you know, we're praying for good weather, so we won't have to have a rain date. But come as you are, and come when you'd like to as well. It's a free hangout, and you know, we're just hoping to have a good amount of folks there representing St. John's. We're going to have our own table and be able to showcase a little bit about what we do and who we are. So good times coming for that, September 21st, this Saturday. A couple other things coming up just to get your get dates on the calendar. Team Trivia Night, we're going to host another one on October 26th, and we're going to have Trunk or Treat again on October 31st. Bible study continues this week with Ecclesiastes. Super excited for this book, so we got Bible study back at 11 on Tuesdays and 7 on Thursdays, and new devotionals are out. You may have seen those. We've got Portals of Prayer and Hopeful Living are the new updated ones that start in October. Everything for the service, as you need to know, is in the bulletin or up on the screen. And God bless our time as He again delivers His promise to us that opens up our ears, loosens our tongue, and promises us the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for gathering your people to hear your promise. We thank you for the proclamation of good news that creates us a new heart and opens our ears and loosens our tongue. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who died on the cross for us and rose from the dead, that we may have the forgiveness of our sins and everlasting life. May we leave in the peace of this good news. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand for our opening hymn.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Since we are gathered to have our faith strengthened by hearing God's word and by receiving our Lord's body and blood at the fellowship of this altar, but cannot come before God in our sinful condition, let us seek his infinite mercy and ask our Heavenly Father's forgiveness. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive the weakness of our faith and our many sins, and restore us to fellowship with you and one another, now and forever. In holy baptism, our Heavenly Father declared us to be his children and united us to his Son, by whose death and resurrection all our sins are forgiven. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. From above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated for the readings of God's Word.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from Isaiah chapter 50, verses 4 through 10. The Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with a word him who is weary. Morning by morning he awakens. He awakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not backward. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard. I hid not my face from disgrace and spitting. But the Lord God helps me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Behold, all of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. Who among you fears the Lord and obeys the voice of his servant? Let him who walks in darkness and has no light trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm appointed for this Sunday is Psalm 116, verses 1 through 9. And let's recite these verses together. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my pleas for mercy. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord preserves the simple. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return, O my soul, to your rest, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living.
The epistle is taken from James chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand. According to St. Mark, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
When they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them, and scribes arguing with them. And immediately all the crowd, when they saw him, were greatly amazed and ran up to Jesus and greeted him. And he asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" And someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they were not able." And he answered them, "O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him. And when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy. And he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And it has often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can, all things are possible for one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe, help my unbelief." And when Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out. And the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why can we not cast it out?" And he said to them, "This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Lord Christ.
You may be seated for our hymn of the day.
Thank you.
dear friends in Christ, Jesus, Peter, James, and John had just come down from the Mount of Transfiguration. That's where they were before our text this morning, and they got to the other disciples. And when they got to the other disciples, what did they find them doing? Arguing. They were arguing, which is another way of saying they were not preaching the gospel. They'd been sent to do that, but they were not doing that. They were arguing. Why do I say that that's not preaching the gospel? When you're arguing with someone, right? I can't imagine we've ever argued with someone. You're trying to get them to agree with you, to accept your position. That's a nice way of putting it, yes. But that's not how the gospel works. The gospel is not some position or a truth that you're presenting so that someone will make the decision to accept it. It's the proclamation of the word of promise that elects, that forgives sins, and gives faith. The gospel even opens the ears of the deaf and loosens the tongue of the mute. Something that poor boy definitely needed. But instead of giving the promise, they decided to sit and argue. They didn't have Facebook back then, so they had to do it actually in person. Even before we are shown the contrast between Jesus and the disciples, certainly in their ability to save, we see the contrast in the crowd. The crowd jumps over to Jesus when he arrives. The crowd left the argument to be near to the one who doesn't engage in arguments, but shuts people up and proclaims the promise. "What are you arguing about with him?" he asked. The disciples had been unable to help this boy. And I know in our lecture we skipped from Mark chapter 7 all the way down to Mark chapter 9. But their inability, I'm going to say, goes all the way back to Mark chapter 8. This is a section that we skipped, but one I know you've heard before. Jesus taught them there that he must be rejected. He's telling this plainly. He must be rejected, he must be killed, and he must be raised. And Peter, if you remember, took him aside and began to rebuke him. "No, Lord, this will not happen to you again." No, absolutely not. He's trying to shut him up. Peter doesn't want this for Jesus, but Jesus is saying that he must die. It is necessary for him to die. And not just to die, but to be killed, right? And to say that it is necessary, that's a word that belongs to the law. It's the law that's going to do it. It's the law that's going to kill Jesus. That means that God will not use the law to make Jesus righteous or to make you or I righteous. It's going to condemn him. It's going to speak the word of condemnation to Jesus. All sins are going to be placed on Jesus. And then Jesus told Peter and the disciples to take up their cross and follow him. And this doesn't mean that Jesus wants you to give all your money to the poor or leave everything and become a monk, dedicating your whole life to prayer 24/7. We've said before what this means. When you take up your cross and you follow Jesus, it means to give the gospel and not the law. It means to preach Christ and him crucified for the forgiveness of sins. It means to preach the gospel. If you try to have your life, if righteousness is going to come by the law, you will lose it. Jesus did not send his disciples to argue. That is, to engage in arguing about the law with some scribes. He wants them to proclaim the gospel, which is that external word that we need. The external word that actually has the power to save. And and to free this boy. O faithless generation, Jesus said. What's the issue? The issue is faith. It's always about faith. The Father had said, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said, and I have to imagine he was smirking a little bit as he said this, because he knows that this guy's got nowhere else to go. No one else has been able to help him. He brings his boy to Jesus. If you can do anything. And Jesus says, if you can, all things are possible for one who believes. And Jesus is not like the disciples here. He is not unable to help. But do you believe? Do you have faith? That's what Jesus is after. All things are possible. All things, this is maybe not the best translation, all things are going to happen. All things are necessary for one who believes. It will all be done. It will all be given to the one who has faith by the promise. Notice what happens next. The Father doesn't say, yeah, sounds good to me. Yes, I believe that. Go and heal. If that were the case, we might start thinking that faith is our response. That it's our decision, you know, our agreement to the facts or our response to a question. We'd see that beautiful faith on display and think that's great, but I doubt that I have faith like that. That's not what he said. First, yes, there was a confession, I believe, but then a prayer. Help my unbelief. Or if you prefer the King James, help thou my unbelief. I love this response because he's like, I think I believe, kind of, but I'm not feeling it. I don't think I have it inside me. Anyone else feeling what this father is going through? Like, yes, I believe that this sounds great. I want to believe, yes, but I don't think I can muster it. I don't think I have it. What a great response. He acknowledges his helplessness. He's coming before Jesus as a beggar. With nothing to give, nothing to offer, begging even for faith itself. Faith is a gift. We know that because, well, that's what the Bible says. But here we see in action that we can't make ourselves believe, that it doesn't originate here. It's not our decision. It's not our response. It's a gift. And we know that faith comes from... I got to wake this up a little bit. Faith comes from hearing, right? And hearing through the word of Christ. This father brought his demon-possessed son to Jesus, hoping that he could do something. And there's plenty of doubt there. And to be fair, the father just witnessed the disciples try to help, but fail. They are unable where Jesus is able. And they certainly thought they could. But they were arguing. Which is another way, again, of saying they were engaged with the law. That is to say, they are relying on their own power. Their own outward actions on what they could do or argue or say. They thought they had it under control, as we all do when it comes to the law. But it turns out the problem was bigger than they thought, and certainly bigger than they could handle. The power to save would not be from them, and it would not come from the law, but from God. From the word of promise. When the disciples privately took Jesus aside and said, why could we not cast it out? He told them, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. Sounds cryptic, but his answer isn't as confusing as it sounds. He's not giving them a blueprint for how to deal with a particular class of demon. Like, oh, you just didn't say the right prayer. And in fact, you're supposed to pray in Latin. You prayed it in Aramaic. You totally messed up. He's not giving the disciples instructions on how not to fail next time. This kind cannot be driven out by anything but Prayer. What is prayer? I assume you pray, right? You know what prayer is. You know what you do when you pray. We send out prayer requests from the congregation all the time. We pray for people and their needs. They come helpless. They come with needs. They come with pain. They come with suffering, fear, anxiety, and worries. Yes, of course, we give thanks to God. We praise Him, and we also ask. We're asking for something. We're coming from a position of need as beggars. I am in need, and I'm helpless. And I think I believe, I hope, but I even need help with that. Only you can help. Like the psalmist says, we call on our God, and He promises to listen. He hears our pleas, and He works all things for our good. The Father certainly has His need, and His prayer to Jesus was, I believe, help my unbelief. He acknowledged His need, His insufficiency, His sin, and His unbelief. If faith is what you want, Jesus, if faith is what you're after, I don't even think I have that. Please give it to me and help me. And Jesus did. He commanded the mute and deaf spirit to leave the boy and never enter him again. The demon left him. The boy looked like he was dead, but Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. It's a beautiful picture of new life, of resurrection. When you're dead, you cannot lift yourself out of the grave. When you're imprisoned by a demon, you can't decide yourself out of it. When you're hearing only your evil heart and your lies and the law, you cannot choose your way out. You can't decide or respond your way out. When you're stuck in unbelief, you can't make yourself believe. What you need is the one who is the resurrection and the life to save you, to personally come to you, to take you by the hand, to lift you up, to speak to you and breathe new life into you. The same God who says, without faith, it's impossible to please me. Is the same God who says, now here's some faith. The same God who says, all things are possible for one who believes, heals the boy and says, well, here's now some faith. The word of Christ opens the ear. It loosens the tongue. It kicks out the demon. And it gives faith. The law and the arguing of the disciples, you see, gets them nowhere. Our psalmist says it this way, the Lord preserves the simple. When I was brought low, He saved me. Going back to Mark chapter 8, the disciples had not taken up their cross. They refused to preach Christ and Him crucified. They refused to die. They came from a position of unfaith, of supposed strength, sufficiency, and ability. But my power, Jesus says, is made perfect in weakness. We think too little of our situation if we think that we can handle it on our own with a blueprint for success. The problem of our sin, the problem of our deceitful hearts, the problem of our unbelief, the problem of death itself cannot be solved by clinging to life, by the law, by our power or our strength or our ability. You don't have that power in yourself. And God is not in the business of giving you the right tools to ensure that you're not helpless. He's not in the business of giving you the tools to make sure that you're not helpless. He's not going to turn you inward to help you find the strength within and to do better next time. He gives you a helper. He gives you a savior. His son, Jesus, who casts out your sin, who takes your hardened heart of stone and replaces it with one of flesh. He takes your unbelief and gives you faith. He takes your death and gives you life. And he does this with a word of promise. He sees you. He hears you. And he alone can save. And he has compassion for you. And he even gives you the faith to trust and believe his promise. For all things are possible, will be given, are necessary for the one, for you, who has been given faith. Our psalmist has this amazing promise for us. He writes, I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Because your sins are forgiven, you will not die but live. God's promise does not depend on the strength, the abundance, or the purity of your faith. It depends on his word, what he says to you. In fact, what Jesus did with this boy is exactly what he did to you at your baptism. Baptism is exorcism. It kicks the demon out. It kicks the devil out. It opens up your ears, gives you a new ear to hear the promise. It loosens your tongue and it raises you from the dead. Jesus makes you new in your baptism. He takes all your sin upon himself and defeats them in his death. And now, because of his words spoken to you, because of his action, because of his ability to save you, you will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. So friends, as you find yourself, and I know you will find yourself in helpless situations, Jesus has given you a cross, and you must die. And you will find yourself as a beggar before him, unable to save yourself, unable to control situations. Skip the arguing and pray. And here's a good one to pray. I believe, help my unbelief. And he does. In fact, he's given me a promise this morning to give to you. Your sins are forgiven. Jesus took them all away from you and defeated them in his death. Your death is defeated, and you will walk before him in the land of the living. Therefore, go in peace. Thanks be to God. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand. We confess our faith together using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for ourselves, the church around the world, and all people in their various conditions. Today's psalm is the response of a trusting person, confident that God has heard the prayer. prayer. Be present, Lord, our God, wherever wars rage and governments fail, where homelessness and disease are rampant, and where the poor are forgotten. I love the Lord. Guard, defend, and give wisdom to all who go into harm's way to do battle against foreign enemies and in emergencies here at home. Use medical personnel and caring neighbors to bring about health and healing. Provide faith-filled leaders and followers to proclaim the gospel, serve you with the gifts you have given them, and care for the needs of people around the world.
Gracious is the Lord.
Be with all who tend flocks, raise harvests, and distribute food so that many may be fed.
Eternal, my soul, to your rest. The Lord has dealt bountifully with you.
Visit, relieve, and console those who are sick or in mourning. We especially lift up to you today Jane Wicks, Barbara and Lenny Stanisic, Eva Porte, Ken Borchers, Dick and Janice Bowens, Tricia Batka, Ginny Liebert-Koster, Paul Koppelman, Allison, Janine, Marilyn Stone, Bill Miller, Stuart Hilton, Sherry Hirsch, Bentley Kelly, John Seiler, Noren Sims, Ryan Kress, Cookie Rossinio, Nora Molloy, and all those we name in our hearts. According to your gracious plans for them, for you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. These and any other things you see that we need, grant to us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Amen. Dear friends, we have peace with God through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us share that peace now with one another. good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming obedient unto death, even death upon a cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, of those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. Grant us now a lively faith as we receive him under bread and wine, and gather us with all the saints to join in the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for this gift of life and the strengthening of our faith. Help us each day to rely on all that your Son has done for us and promised for our future. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
As we receive the blessing of our Lord, we place our hands out in front of us like a cup. To remind us of our position before God, we come as beggars, helpless, with inability, and he has the ability and the compassion to save, and he does. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
And we continue with our closing hymn. Faithfulness, not our own. Go in the abounding grace of our God, and God's blessings on your week. Amen.